faith is a journey. It's an unwavering trust that God will show you the way through life's toughest moments. Faith is confidence in what we hope for, and it's an assurance about things we can't see. Faith is a walk that God promises will lead to a life of fullness and purpose. I will stand in it, let the church rise up. Faith is a journey that you'll never take alone. So let's start walking by it.
The very first thing I want to do this morning is I want to ask a question. And the question that I want to pose is, who is the greatest in the kingdom of God? When you think about all of the men, mighty men and women throughout history, throughout the Bible, throughout God's people and doing God's work, who is the greatest? Could be Elijah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, any one of them. Who? Nehemiah, Ezra. Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? This is the exact picture of what we see the disciples doing when they came to Jesus. In Matthew chapter 18, you could turn your Bibles there. Starting at verse 1, it says, "And at that time the disciples came to Jesus and said, 'Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?' And he called a child to himself and set him before them and said, 'Truly I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever then humbles themselves as this child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven.'" So the disciples come to Jesus and they say, "Who? Jesus is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." And you can imagine them listing off all of these different names, all of these different people, all of their different accomplishments. But then Jesus does something. He sees little children, and he calls one of them over to him. And he stands them right before himself, facing his disciples. And he says, "I tell you, unless you are converted and become like little children, you will not even see the kingdom of heaven." Could you imagine how that would throw them back? Like, what? Like, we've been casting out demons. We've been healing the sick. We've been preaching the word of God. We've been declaring the mysteries that you've been declaring to us. We've been bringing glory to your name. And you're telling us that we have to become like this little child to even be able to see the kingdom of heaven? But what was he saying? First of all, to be converted means to turn. It means to be changed. And it actually gives this picture of a dynamic change, an immediate change, a sudden change, a hard change. It's as if I'm going 100 miles an hour in one direction and all of a sudden I hit the emergency brake and I start drifting and now I'm going in the completely opposite direction that I just came from. It gives that type of imagery. So he's saying you have to be converted. You have to be changed. You have to be transformed. You have to turn around, turn from the way that you're going right now, turn from the thinking that you are thinking right now, and you have to become like little children. What is he saying? He's saying, unless you become sons and daughters of God, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. It doesn't matter about what people did. It doesn't matter about what they accomplished. It doesn't matter about all of the great things that you've done up until this point. If you are not a son or daughter of God, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. Now, you might be asking, well, how do I become like a child? How do I become a son or daughter of God? It's very simple. We become children of God by faith in Jesus Christ, believing that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, that he rose again 3 days for our justification, for us to be justified before God, for us to be forgiven, for us to be made righteous, for us to receive the righteousness and the goodness of Christ upon ourselves. So when God the Father looks at us, he doesn't see all the filth that we've done, nor does he see the good works that we've done. What he sees is the very righteousness of Jesus Christ. He sees the very sacrifice that his son made on the cross. And then we believe that Jesus Christ ascended up to heaven and he's seated at the right hand of the Father and he's interceding for us, and that one day he's going to come back again, and he's going to come back and he's going to restore everything the way that it's supposed to be, every single way that it was, that the earth and God's creation was intended to be. He's going to restore it all back to that place. And he's going to take those who are his to be with him, to rule and reign forever. But those that are not his, those that are not sons and daughters of God, are going to be cast into the lake of fire to be tormented and to burn, to live in misery, to live apart from God for all eternity. But if you put your faith in Jesus Christ today and you surrender your life to Jesus Christ today, you are and will be a son or daughter of God. You will be converted. You will be changed. You will be transformed. The Spirit of God will come to live inside of you. But that is what he's saying. You must first be converted and become like little children, become sons and daughters of God, or you won't even enter into the kingdom of God. But then he goes on to say this. He said, whoever humbles themselves as this little child, they are the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So the theme that we're going to be talking about today is childlike faith. But I am convinced that childlike faith isn't necessarily having the faith of a child. When we read in scripture, childlike faith is a normal saying in Christendom and Christianity. We talk about having childlike faith. But childlike faith isn't necessarily found anywhere in scripture. But I believe that it is a concept, but it's not a concept of having faith like a child. I believe childlike faith is to take the posture of a child, which produces faith as a mustard seed. In Hebrews chapter 11, starting at verse 33, we see people in Hebrews chapter 11. We see all of the people, the great, the men and women of God throughout history that have done amazing things. We see all of these people. These are people that had a mustard seed faith. They had faith that was pure. They had faith that was, as we talked about in our very first session when we explained what faith was. Faith is complete. It's trust in Jesus Christ. It's having him as our substance. It's having him as our source. And that is what mustard seed faith is. It's having a pure faith. It's not about the size of it. It's not about the quantity of it. It's about the quality of it. It's their faith was pure. They made mistakes, but their faith was pure. And all of these people in Hebrews chapter 11 are people that had childlike faith. They're people that took the posture of a child. They're people that had that mustard seed faith. If you remember, Jesus Christ told his disciples, he said, if you had the faith of a mustard seed, you could look to this mountain and you could say, get up, be removed from your place and be cast into the sea. And then he goes on to say, and nothing would be impossible for you if you just had that mustard seed of faith, that pure, raw faith that trusts in me and trusts in my word beyond anything else, that takes my word for what it is, that when I say something, then that's what it is, and that is what pure and raw faith is. But these are people that had that type of faith, that when God said it, that settled it, that was it, and that's what they did, that's where they went, that's where they invested. They were all in, completely invested into what God had said. So therefore, if they were able to have faith in God, that childlike faith in God, that to take that posture of a child and have that relationship with God that produced this faith, that was able to overcome and conquer kingdoms, perform acts of righteousness, obtain promises, shut the mouths of lions, quench the power of fire, escape the edge of the sword, if they were able to have faith that were able to keep them in the midst of being stoned, in the midst of being sawn in two, in the midst of all of their persecutions and afflictions, in the midst of people rejecting them and them feeling all alone, if they were able to do that without having received the promised Messiah, but now we have him. We know him. We believe in him. We've put our trust in him. If they did it, how much more could we do it by faith in Jesus Christ? Because we now have the fulfillment of the source, of the substance, who is Christ, and is Christ alone. Hallelujah. The title of my message today is A Child's Pose. A Child's Pose. A child's pose is a stretch. And in this stretch, what you do is you get down on your knees, you put your face to the ground, and you stretch your hands out. This very pose, this very stretch, is actually one of the greatest forms of worship that the Bible even talks about and tells us to do. Bowing down before the Lord. And I just find it very ironic that it's called, that the very posture that you could take on bowing down and putting your face to the ground and stretching your hands out would be called a child's pose. And I believe it's because a child, taking the posture of a child is one of the truest forms of worship that we could possibly have. Taking that posture. But what is that posture? Glad you asked. The first thing we want to look at is that the posture of a child is one that clings. Matthew 20, verse 20 through 23 says, "Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to Jesus with her sons, bowing down, taking the posture of a child, doing the child's pose, and making a request of him. He said to her, 'What do you wish?' She said to him, 'Command that in your kingdom these two sons of mine may sit on your right and on your left.' But Jesus answered, 'You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink?' They said to him, 'We are able.' He said to them, 'My cup you shall drink, but to sit on my right hand and on my left, this is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father.'" I'm convinced that James and John, who are the sons of Zebedee, these are the sons that she's talking about. I believe that James and John understood what it meant to take that posture. I believe they understood that to be close to him, to be near him, was the greatest gift that you could possibly have. It's the greatest gift that you could possibly receive, is to be close, the closest to him forever, for all eternity, to be at his right or at his left hand, which is the posture of a child. If you think about a child, what does a child do? They cling to you. They cling to their parents. They cling to their mother or their father. When they're afraid, they come and they cling. When they're sad or when they're hurt, they come and they cling. When they want to be near you and they want to be with you, they come and they cling, and to where they'll even lay their head and rest their head on your chest, or as you're watching a movie, or if they're tired, they'll come and they'll lay on you, or they'll lay beside you and clinging to you. Taking the posture of a child is taking is one that clings. It's clinging to the Lord. It's clinging to God the Father as we are take on the posture of his sons and daughters. I believe that, I know that John understood it, because if you read his three epistles that he wrote, all throughout each and every one of them, he constantly uses the phrase, little children. He understood. Now, he wasn't a children's pastor. He wasn't a youth pastor. He wasn't writing his letters to children or to youth. He was writing his letters to all of the church, but yet he called them little children because he understood the concept of what it meant and the importance of what it meant to be little children to God, and that God sees us as his little children, but we have to see ourselves as God's children, as his sons and daughters, to where we come, not only that we know it, but that we act like it, that we act like his sons and daughters, that we live like his sons and daughters, that we would take that posture of a son and daughter, that would come and that would cling to our Father, that we would cling to God, that we would be close to him and want to be near him. I'd be willing to say that if we, as Christians or followers of Christ, if we did not want to be near God, I'd be willing to say that we might not be his children. We might not be his sons and daughters. If we don't desire him, to desire to be with him, desire to be near him, to desire to be close to him, to desire to know him more and more, I would say that we probably aren't his sons and daughters, that we probably aren't his little children. But that can change right now. That can change in a moment. All you have to do is cry out to him and say, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Lord, I believe. Come and be with me. I want to be with you. But Mary, if you remember Mary and Martha, two sisters, they lived in Bethany. They were the sisters of Lazarus, who Jesus Christ raised from the dead. But they were having a gathering in their home. And in this gathering, Martha was rummaging around. She was working hard. She was serving. She was cooking. She was cleaning. She was doing all of these things while Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus. And she comes in and she looks at Jesus. She says, Jesus, can't you look at everything that I'm doing? I'm doing all of this work and Mary's not helping me. Can you please tell her to come and to help me? And he looks at Martha and he says, Martha, Mary has chosen the one thing that is needed and it will not be taken from her. See, Mary took the posture of a child. To sit at the feet of Jesus was to take that posture. What do children do at story time? When you have story time, children come and they gather and they all sit at your feet, listening intently, clinging to every single word that you're saying, clinging to everything and intently wanting to know what's next in the story. And they sit there at your feet listening to this. And this is what Mary was doing. She understood. She understood about taking the posture of a child. John, again, when they were all sitting at the table, he was sitting beside Jesus and they were about to eat the Passover meal. And it says that John had his head rested upon the chest of Jesus Christ. This again, it's taking the posture of a child, resting your head on his chest. What happens? What's the first thing that you do when a baby comes out of the womb? You put that baby right there on the chest of the mother, where there's skin to skin, because there's comfort. And what begins to happen as the baby lays there on the mother's chest or the father's chest, whoever it is, their heartbeats begin to match. When we take the posture of a child and we cling to our father and we rest ourselves upon his chest, we begin to feel his heartbeat. We begin to feel what his heart beats for and what his heart beats after. We begin to be like him. The second thing that I want to look at is the posture of a child as one of dependency. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." Children are dependent upon their parents. They're dependent upon their guardians. They're dependent upon them for guiding them, for teaching them, for instructing them. They're dependent upon them to provide for them. They're dependent upon them for everything, to take care of them, to protect them, to feed them. They're completely dependent upon those that are watching over them. And in the same way, when we take upon ourselves, when we assume the position or the posture of a child, we become dependent upon God. We no longer trust in ourselves or in our own works or in our own strength, but we trust in the Lord with all of our heart. We no longer lean on our own understanding. We no longer lean on our own wisdom or our own ways or our own logic or our own reasoning, but we lean on God. We lean on his understanding, and we no longer are acknowledging ourselves and what we can do or what we intend to do, but we acknowledge God in all of our ways, and he makes our path straight. The only thing that is The only thing that is going to come about from us trusting in ourselves, from us leaning on our own understanding, for us not acknowledging God, but acknowledging our own mights, our own strengths, our own goodness, is nothing but crooked paths. Because it goes back and forth because we as people are double-minded. We can't make up our mind. We go back and forth on, is this right or is this right? We contradict ourselves, but in God, we can keep a straight path. We can walk that narrow path, and we can go straight forward, trusting and knowing that our paths are laid out for us and that God is going to direct us, and we don't have to worry about going back and forth. We don't have to worry about what's ahead because we know that God is going to take care of us. In Psalm 121, verses 1 through 2, it says that our help comes from the Lord. In John 15, 5, it says that it talks about how we are the branches and Christ Jesus is the vine. And what that tells us is that as the branches need the vine, so do we need Jesus Christ. We need him. We're dependent upon him. He's the source. The vine is the source of all nutrients, the source of all strength. He is the vine. He is our source for strength and for nutrients. Psalm 23 talks about how the Lord is our shepherd. And a shepherd takes care of the sheep. The shepherd guides the sheep. Shepherd protects the sheep, gives rest to the sheep. It restores the soul, the Bible says. He is our shepherd. In Exodus 14:14, it says that the Lord fights for us. In Psalm 127:1, it says, unless the Lord builds the house, those who labor, labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, those who sit upon the walls to watch over the city, watch in vain. In other words, what it's telling us is that unless the Lord is doing it, if we're not dependent upon him and we're doing it in our own strength and we're going in our own way, we're doing it in vain. We're doing it for nothing. What that tells us is that we need to know what God is doing. We need to know what God's hand is in. We need to know where God's footprints are leading. And we need to get a part of what he is doing. We need to get a part of where he is going. We need to get a part of what he is thinking. We need to know what God is doing. 1 Chronicles 29:14 tells us that all things come from the Lord. In this verse, it's a person crying out to God. They said, how can we be so generous with what we have? And it goes on to say, it's because all things come from you. All things come from the Lord. There's nothing that we have received, that we haven't first received. That's why people who are typically givers understand this concept. If you're a giver to this morning, if you're a person that just naturally gives, you want to give to people, you want to bless people, you want to give to different things, you want to give to missions, whatever it is, however you want to give, if you're a giving person this morning, it's probably, most likely, because you understand the concept that there's nothing that you have that you didn't first receive. And what I find is that's, a lot of times when we struggle to give, it's because we think, when we take on the mindset that I labored for this, I worked for this, I struggled for this, why am I going to give what I worked so hard for to somebody else who didn't? We take on that mindset. We don't have the mindset that everything that we have, we received it first from God. Because if we did, we wouldn't be gripping it so tight. We wouldn't be holding on to it so tight. Because the truth of the matter is that even if you did it by the strength of your hands, it was God who provided the strength. Even if you did it or accomplished it by the wit that's within your mind, by your logic or by your reason or by your intelligence, it was God who provided you with the intelligence. Every single thing that you are able to do or that you have accomplished, it's all been by God, whether you believe in him or not. It's because God has provided your heart to even beat, your lungs to even breathe, that you have been able to accomplish it. There's nothing that you haven't first received. Psalm 44:3 says that the Lord provides victory. Romans 12:4-5 tells us that if we have believed in Christ, then we are the body of Christ, each one of us members of the body. I might be the thumb, you might be the finger, somebody else might be the arm, somebody else might be the kneecap, but we all form together one body, but guess what a body needs? A body needs a head. If a body doesn't have a head, then it's no good. And the very moment that a body loses connection with the head, that body might be as strong as physically possible, but the very moment it loses connection with the head, that body becomes weak, that body becomes sluggish, that body becomes slow, that body starts to be able to lose the function that it was able to have in order to fulfill what it was intended to do. So we are dependent upon the head. Psalm 54:4 says that he sustains me. So if all of these things be true, if all of these things be true, then why wouldn't we depend on God? Why wouldn't we trust in him with all of our heart and lean not on our own understanding? After all, that is what it's like to take upon the posture of a child. And to have childlike faith is to take that posture of a child, which therefore produces that faith of a mustard seed. The third thing I want us to look at is that a posture of a child is one of humility. Very first and foremost, it takes humility, humbling ourselves, the Bible says, to even become as one of, to even become as little children. But in verse 4, Jesus of chapter 18 in Matthew says, whosoever therefore shall humble themselves as this little child, that little child that Jesus Christ brought before the disciples. And he says, unless you be converted and become like this little child, you won't even see the kingdom. But whosoever shall humble themselves as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. See, one of the things that Mark tells us that Matthew left out, and I don't know if Matthew is trying to make them look better than they were or what, but in Mark chapter 9, verse 33 through 34, he tells us a little bit more of the story of what happened. See, they did. They came to Jesus and they said, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? But before this, or when that happened, what Mark tells us is that after they asked him that, before he brought the child, he looked at them and he said, what were you arguing about along the way? See, what happened prior to them getting to this moment is that on their journey, the whole way that they were traveling, they were actually arguing among themselves who the greatest among them were, who was going to be the greatest among them, among the 12. They were arguing amongst themselves. You could probably imagine it, them going back and forth and saying, you know, I've casted out more demons, and somebody else saying, you know, I've healed more sick, and somebody else saying, I'm a better preacher. You could just imagine them all going back and forth. Some of them maybe even using their love for Jesus as making the one as the what determines them to be the greatest, saying, I love Jesus more, I cling to him more. And Jesus asked them, he says, what were you arguing about along the way? You know what their answer was? Their answer was silence. It says they all remained silent because along the way that they were arguing about who among themselves would be the greatest. They were convicted. They were afraid. They didn't even want to talk about it anymore. They didn't even want to say what they were arguing about, because they knew how foolish it would have been. It would have sounded. How prideful it would have sounded. Pride is what got Satan kicked out of the kingdom. But after that, that's when Jesus brings before them a child. But even this saying itself, Jesus says, Jesus says, whoever humbles himself as this little child, the same as the greatest in the kingdom. And even today, I believe that we could take this saying and we can automatically assume that Jesus Christ is trying to give us the secret sauce, so to speak, to greatness. He's trying to give us one of the 10 mysteries or secrets to being great. But he's not. Jesus is not trying to tell them the secret of how to be great. Jesus is just trying to tell them to be humble. He's trying to tell them to humble themselves. In James chapter 4, verse 6 through 10, James says, but he gives a greater grace. Therefore it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. Now, James is not, he's not coming after them because they're joyful, because they have the joy of the Lord. He's not coming after them because trying to tell them that you can never be happy, that you can't laugh, that you can't do any of this. He's not coming after them to tell them that. What he's trying to drive home is that you need to humble yourself. You need to submit yourself to God. You need to stop playing around. You need to stop thinking that you can, that this life is just a game, or that your Christianity is just a game, that what you do doesn't matter, or what you don't do doesn't matter. He's trying to tell them you need to humble yourself before God. You need, because he opposes the proud. You need to submit yourselves to God. And if you do, there's a greater grace. There's a greater grace to be able to resist the devil. There's a greater grace to be able to draw near to God. There's a greater grace to be able to cleanse your hands. If you have been living in sin and you have been living in what displeases God, there's a greater grace to be able to get out and to get free from that sin, to stop living in it. There's a greater grace if you have been double-minded, to be able to purify your hearts to where you no longer are swayed back and forth between the world and between the kingdom of God, but that you can have a singleness of mind to where it's God and God alone, and your focus is God and your pursuit is God. There's a greater grace for that if you would humble yourselves and you would submit to God. And he says that God will exalt you. In 1 Peter 5, 5 and 6, Peter says, and all of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. For God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. The more we humble ourselves, the more we will look like Jesus. The more we look like Jesus, the more humble we will look. Humility in the world is defined as considering yourself as less or as worthless. If you look up the definition, that's what you'll see. You'll see it talking about being less or being worthless. In the kingdom, that's not humility, that's bondage. It means that you have bought the lies of Satan instead of receiving the truth of God. To say you're worth nothing is to say Christ paid such a high price for no reason, and that is false humility. One of the forms of false humility is a humble attempt, but not on the grounds of what is true. It's saying something humble, but not on the grounds of what is actually true. In other words, it'd be like saying you're nothing, saying you're worthless, saying you have nothing to offer, saying that the gifts that God gave you, that downplaying them. That would be a form of false humility, because what is true is that you are something, because God has put his gifts and his callings into each and every single person. There's no person that lives in this earth that is living and moving and breathing that does not have the gifts and callings of God on the inside of them. The Bible says that the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. In other words, they are there and they are there to stay. The only difference is when we don't come to God and we don't make him our source or make him our substance, is we can't recognize what God had put inside of us. Or if we do recognize it, we don't use it to its fullest potential. We don't allow it to be able to function for his glory, but we manipulate it and we pervert it and we use it for our own vainglory or our own selfish ambition. And to say that you're worthless couldn't be farther from the truth. Like I said, it would be to say that Christ did everything that he did for nothing, that you weren't worth it. But then another form of false humility is a humble action without a humble heart. For an example, a lot of people do it in the world, but it's to make a humble statement that has the form of humility, may seem humble, but the whole time You're actually looking for an adverse effect. You're actually doing it to fish for something else. You're fishing for praise. It might look like me saying, oh man, I'm so terrible at this, but you're saying it with the heart of hoping that they'll actually tell you the opposite of what you're saying, because you're looking for something. You're looking for some type of admonition. You're looking for some type of affirmation. So it's having a form of humility, but not with a humble heart, true humbleness of heart. True humility is not seeing yourself as less, but just seeing yourself less. Considering others more than yourself. Not looking at your own desires, or not looking at your own selfish ambitions, or your own, not looking at yourself, but looking at others. Looking at what benefits others. Considering others more than yourself. More than you consider yourself. To be humble is to see yourself how God sees you. Just think of others more often. In the kingdom, humility looks like submission and service, submitting to God and serving people. Which brings us to the fourth thing that I want us to look at. And that's the posture of a child is one of serving. My daughters love to serve me and my wife. When I ask somebody to feed the dog, to feed the cat, to turn on the light, to turn off the light, to turn on the fan, turn off the fan, to grab something, this, where, whatever it is, they will literally race to try to be the first one to accomplish this task. And if one of them comes in second, they are extremely upset, so much to the point that I have to console them and I have to give them something else to do as well, so that way they won't be upset. They love to serve us. And the posture of a child is one of service. It's naturally to serve. You get enjoyment, you get fulfillment from actually serving other people, from actually serving those that you love. And so to take the posture of a child is to take the posture of serving God first and foremost, and then serving people as well. In Matthew chapter 20, going back again, remember the first time we were in Matthew 20, the mother of James and John came to Jesus asking if they can sit on the right and left hand of his throne. Now continuing on right after that, in verse 24, it says, in hearing this, the other ten disciples became indignant. They were mad with the two brothers. But Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great men exercise authority over them. It is not this way among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and give his life a ransom for many. The first thing I want to look at is that the moment you begin to function or operate in childlike faith, the moment you begin to operate and function as a child, as a son or daughter of God, people are going to get mad. People are going to get mad at you. They're going to despise you. They're going to look at you differently when they see you operating and functioning in this childlikeness. In Luke 22:27, Jesus also says, he adds to this, Luke tells us a little bit more. He says, for who is greater, the one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. In other words, our Savior, no one humbled themselves more and became more of a servant than Jesus. No one did. Our Savior, our King, he humbled himself and he came to serve. He said, I didn't come to be served. I didn't come to do that. I came to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many people. And if I, your Lord, have done it, if I, your Master, your Savior, have done it, your King has done it, why would you not do it? Is a servant greater than his Master? And he says, who is greater, the one who sits at the table or the one who serves? the one who sits at the table, but he said, I am among you as one who serves. His whole mission was to come and to serve humanity. That's why he healed the sick. That's why he cast out demons. That's why he raised the dead. That's why he preached the gospel to the poor. That's why he did all of these amazing and mighty things. That's why he put up with humanity. He put up with mankind. That's why he put up with their lack of faith and their disobedience, because he came to serve. And if he came to serve and he came and he did all of those things, how could we not begin to serve and love one another and humble ourselves before the people that God has also created? In Philippians 2, 5 to 11, this is what it says. It says, have this attitude. If you're going to have an attitude, have this attitude. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus Christ's whole mission, he came and he humbled himself. He is God. He is eternally God. He was always existent. He is the Word before anything. He was the Word that God spoke and it was. He is the light of the world. He is the lamb slain before the foundations of the world. He has always existed, being equal with God, but yet he did not consider that as something to come to earth and flaunt or to gloat or to do anything of that nature, but yet he humbled himself and became just like one of us, enduring all the temptations that we've endured. Many men throughout history have tried to take and toke the claim of them being God, and they've tried to reign, just like he just said, the kings of the Gentiles, the great men throughout history, they've reigned over people. They've exalted it over people. They've pressed it over people. I am your king. I am your God. But the very one and only true and living God of all creation that's always been actually did the complete opposite. He came from heaven to earth, took upon himself the form of a man, and became like man and obedient to humbled himself even to the point of being obedient to death, even the death of the cross. I had to try to get that out. But for this reason, those who humble themselves, God exalts. For this reason, God also highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. When we humble ourselves and we take upon ourselves the form of a servant, just like our Lord and our Master and our King, in the same way that he was also highly exalted, God exalts us. He exalts us. So that call that God has upon your life, that vision that God has given you, If you want that to be fulfilled, if you want that to be reached, you need to begin to humble yourself. Because it's not until you humble yourself that he will then exalt you unto that position. Because he's not going to put you somewhere that you don't have the character to contain. You know, the Bible says that your gift will make room for you and bring you before the presence of many great men, but your character will keep you there. Your character will keep you in the room. Your humility will keep you in the room. So humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. In Acts 3:13 and 4:27, when they were talking about Jesus and sharing the gospel to the people, they presented him in this way. They said, the holy servant Jesus. The holy servant Jesus. They knew that that was his whole mission. But even Jesus first took upon himself the posture of a child by being a son, by being the Son of God and calling him the Father. See, Jesus Christ, the God being the Father of the world, had always been had always been a thing. The Israelites would, if you asked if God was their father, they would say yes, but it was such an abstract concept. It wasn't a reality for them. It was like knowing the right thing to say, but not believing it in your heart. But when Jesus Christ came, he brought upon us that reality. He made it a reality. He made it true. First starting with himself, saying that he is the Son of God, becoming that son. And then likewise, we too, when we put our faith and our trust in him, we become sons and daughters. But Paul understood he was a servant. And most of his greetings, he greets himself as Paul, the servant of Jesus Christ. And then last but not least, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5 through 6, Paul says, "For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus as Lord, and ourselves as bondservants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Light shall shine out of darkness,' is the one who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." He said, "We do not preach ourselves, but Christ as Lord, and we your servants." That's the message, the posture of a child is becoming a servant. So to conclude, childlike faith is being dependent on God, humble to God, and acting humbly with people, becoming a servant of God and of people, learning to cling to him above all else, because it's the one thing needed and the one thing that won't be taken away. God bless you guys. Love you. If you're going to give your life to Christ today, if you want to know God, put it in the chat. We'll have somebody reach out to you. We'll love you guys. God bless you.